Hi there, Doug Stuman with IT Creations with a high-performance 2U server from Lenovo, the Lenovo ThinkSystem SR650 V2 server. This platform features dual third-generation Intel Xeon Scalable processors, up to 8 terabytes of memory, and depending on how you configure it, there's room for up to 42.5-inch drive bays, or up to 8 single-width GPUs, or 3 double-width GPUs, and various combinations in between. It'll even take that Nvidia A100 80GB GPU, ideal for compute acceleration, AI, and machine learning. This is a high-density server in a 2U form factor that can be adapted to just about any HPC workload. Let's dig in. You know, I almost want to switch those first two letters around and call it the RS650 for racing sport, like if this was a high-performance vehicle. It's designed for machine learning, cloud workloads, virtualization, and cloud-based analytics. It can be outfitted with third-generation Intel Xeon Scalable CPUs with up to 40 cores each, and with two, that's up to 80 cores. This is an expansion of the base system SR650 and features high-density storage options using Lenovo's AnyBay backplane design to allow for SAS, SATA, or NVMe U.2 or U.3 drives in any bay. If computational acceleration is needed, this platform can support 8 single-width PCI GPUs like the Nvidia A2 or up to 3 double-width GPUs, like the Nvidia A100 80GB and A6000. However, I will mention those various configurations are not without compromise, because you can't have it all. Forgetting about the additional storage options for an internal drive cage and rear storage cages for a moment, there are 3.5-inch and 2.5-inch storage options supporting SAS, SATA, and NVMe storage devices. There's even a backplane-less version for compute only. The front of the system can have up to 24 2.5-inch drive bays, but there are also configurations with 8 and 16 2.5-inch drive bays with or without an optional LCD diagnostics panel. The 3.5-inch drive bay chassis comes with either 8 or 12 storage bays in front. In the end, the 3.5-inch chassis will support up to 20 3.5-inch drive bays, taking into account internal and rear storage cage options. That is, if you decide to maximize storage. Depending on which storage condition you choose on the front, there are either two small control panels in each of the server ears or just the left server ear control panel with a front I/O assembly on the media bay. It's hard not to see one of these powering your network, am I right? I mean, highly configurable, flexible, and with Lenovo's reliability built right in. If you want one, we can get you one, and you can save up to $500 off a system listed on our site or one that you configure that's listed at $5,000 or more. Just click that link for more information. He'll be doing donuts at the intersection of data and compute with one of these babies. For accessories like rims and a wing, you'll have to shop elsewhere. The control panel on the right offers an on-off button, network activity, system ID, and system error ID button, each with LED lights for status. Right below those, two USB ports, one 2.0 connector for use with the xClarity controller mobile app, and the other, a USB 3.2 Gen 1 port that can be used to connect a keyboard, mouse, or USB storage device. You can also set the 2.0 port to connect to just USB devices, the xClarity controller management function, or both. An optional Insight display panel provides even more granular data on system status, but it's only available on certain configurations that support the optional media bay. It offers a status dashboard and LED screen with a few buttons to scroll through the various menus. There's even an external diagnostic connector that attaches to the system with a cable. It can be plugged into one of the ports on the left server ear and connects to the xClarity controller for at-chassis management of the system. The magnetic base lets you attach it to the server rack and connect it to the other Lenovo systems in the network without fumbling around with the actual controller. Coffee, hello. Just below that, an optional VGA port, or maybe not. And here a little segue. The system came with dual third-generation Intel Xeon Scalable Silver family processors, specifically Silver 4314 processors. These have 16 physical cores and 32 virtual threads, plus a base frequency of 2.4 gigahertz and a maximum turbo frequency of 3.4 gigahertz. It also had all memory module slots filled with 16 gigabyte modules for 512 gigabytes of memory, four 375 gigabyte NVMe drives in front and two 1800 watt PSUs. All that information is available in inventory once you open the xClarity controller. Several other features help manage the system, including an event log, utilization of system resources, storage details, and RAID configurations, a remote console, firmware update, server configuration, and baseboard management controller configuration. Lenovo's xClarity controller is designed to standardize, simplify, and automate management tasks. An optional upgrade is the xClarity Controller Advanced for remote control keyboard, video, mouse functions. And then there's also xClarity Enterprise, enabling remote media files, boot capture, and power capping. xClarity Administrator provides all the tools for administrators to manage the system, ensuring it stays up and running. Let's get back to the hardware. Going around to the back of the system, there are a few more options for adding more storage, either 2.5 inch, 3.5 inch, or two 7 millimeter drives that can be used to boot the system. Some of the rear PCI slots can be conscripted to support an 8 bay 2.5 inch drive cage, or another with support for up to four 2.5 inch drives. A 2 bay 3.5 inch drive cage can also be installed above the PSUs, or you can go with a 4 bay 3.5 inch drive cage for even more flexibility that will straddle the entire back panel. You know, it was at this point that I thought perhaps Lenovo was just showing off or something. And we haven't even gotten to the internally mounted optional drive cages. Before we do, let's take a quick look at the other items in the back of the system. The dual redundant PSUs can support several different power outputs depending on power needs and are stacked on the far right, side by side. Next to those, there's a non-maskable interrupt button, USB 3.0 port, VGA port connector, a few more USB ports, and a system error LED. The dedicated port to access the baseboard management controller, or BMC, is next, followed by the system ID button and an OCP 3.0 Ethernet adapter. The OCP 3.0 adapter is optional and provides 2 to 4 ports and various connection speeds, depending on your needs. Quite handy, too, if you plan on installing GPUs in all of those 8 rear accessible PCI slots above, as there are no integrated LAN ports. With up to 8 PCI slots available, you can add more storage, as we've already discussed, networking cards, or GPUs for compute acceleration or distributed environments. Flexibility this system offers is truly impressive. Inside their case, there is even more potential for configuration options, including, you guessed it, more storage. A drive cage supporting 8 2.5 inch, or another one with 4 3.5 inch drives that can be installed, adding to an already impressive storage capacity. The 2.5 inch chassis will support the most storage with up to 40 drive bays, including 24 in front, 8 internally mounted drives, and 8 more in back. The 8-bay drive cage can also support the battery to power the system for roughly a minute until data and memory can be transferred to the main drives. There is a dedicated socket just behind the backplane for an HBA RAID controller, so you won't have to use up one of those PCI slots. The system will take up to 32 NVMe storage devices, but only using switch adapters in the PCI slots. 32 NVMe drives equates to a 2-to-1 oversubscription, which could impact network performance, but only if you plan on flooding the network with maximum traffic at the same time. If you install only 16 NVMe drives, then you have a 1-to-1 connectivity, maximizing throughput and minimizing latency. Those things you should probably figure out before you configure the system. You may be thinking about cooling at this point, and all that storage potential blocking airflow, but that's not the case. The CPUs, which would reside under the internal drive cage, are connected to radiators that connect just behind the 5 fans and then to heat sinks on the CPUs. Kind of what you might see in a high-performance vehicle with an additional oil cooler to take that extra heat load. I mean, our system doesn't have that, but it could. However, everything on this system is very well engineered to maintain a suitable environment for calculating reams of data and supporting some high-performance heat-generating hardware. A truly elegant design. Those heat sinks provide cooling for 1 or 2 third-generation Intel Xeon Scalable processors with 4 to 40 cores and a thermal design point of up to 270 watts each. With PCI 4.0, those processors deliver the bandwidth needed to provide the best throughput for I/O and NVMe storage options, not to mention GPU support, which we will get to in a minute. Third-generation Intel Xeon Scalable processors require a slightly larger socket than the first and second-generation processors, which are completely incompatible with this platform because of that larger socket. Another upgrade from the previous generation is 8 memory channels compared to only 6 on the previous CPU versions. 8 memory channels mean more memory and faster too. Well, actually the memory speed has no relation to the number of memory channels, but 3200 megahertz memory is now supported. These improvements define Lenovo's ninja way, as Naruto might say, providing reliability, availability, and serviceability, or RAS, if you want that acronym. Each socket is in charge of 16 memory module slots for 32 total on the system board. The SR650 V2 will support up to 12 terabytes at maximum capacity using a combination of 4 terabytes of registered DIMMs and 8 terabytes of persistent memory modules used for storage. Another option provides up to 10 terabytes, but this time with persistent memory providing system memory, while the RDIMMs provide a layer of cache memory. Without using persistent memory, you can install up to 2 terabytes of standard registered DIMMs at 64 gigabytes each, or up to 8 terabytes of 3DS registered DIMMs at 256 gigabytes each. A warning, this is the boring part. One of the benefits of PMem modules is it has 2 accessibility modes, either memory mode, where it performs the same function as DRAM modules and persistence is really not part of the equation, or application direct mode. Actually, there's 3 modes, because there is a mixed mode, combining the two, but let's stick to the basics. Application direct mode is more like traditional storage, but in a memory module form factor. Depending on how the persistence memory is configured in BIOS, it can either be used for storage or system memory. PMem is slower than DRAM modules in that the access speed is about 350 nanoseconds compared to only 14 nanoseconds with standard DRAMs. However, what it lacks in speed, it makes up for in persistence. Without power, standard DRAMs lose their storage potential and whatever is running around in the circuits. With the persistence offered by PMem, the modules can be treated almost like permanent storage drives. It's designed to keep more data closer to the CPU if used as direct access, with PMem providing a slower memory tier while DRAM provides the faster memory tier. Enough of this. PCIe 4.0 provides twice the bandwidth of PCIe 3.0 and not only improves I/O and NVMe storage performance, but also enables more PCIe lanes. With third-gen processors, there are actually 64 PCIe 4.0 lanes compared to only 48 PCIe lanes on the previous generations, so significantly more bandwidth. There are 8x16 PCIe slots on 3 separate risers in addition to an OCP 3.0 mezzanine card slot for network communications. There's even 2x4 PCIe slots on the system board to support 1 or 2 M.2 drives in mirror mode for redundancy to support the operating system. This thing has it all, and I'm not really sure what else they could shoehorn in there. Oh wait, we haven't even gotten to the GPUs yet. So 8 PCIe slots that you can install up to 8 single-width GPUs like the Nvidia T4, which let's face it is kind of old at this point, but still a great option for distributed environments and reasonable compute acceleration. In this less than 75 watt category, there is also the option of the A2 and the A4 GPUs from Nvidia, both based on Ampere technology. You really will need that OCP 3.0 card slot if you max out with 8 of these though. Alternatively, there are mid-range options like the A10 and then some super performers like the A100 and the A6000, also based on Ampere architecture. But you can only install 3 of those double width cards and you may still be out of slots given the card width. Many of these GPU configurations will affect the amount and type of storage too, perhaps the memory and the type of heat sinks you install also. Just a few things to keep in mind. For a 2U system, this one truly does it all and can support not only a little podunk business, but a large enterprise business depending on how it's configured. It's quite impressive and definitely built to scale as your business grows or your needs change. In many ways, I feel like I've only scratched the surface of the capabilities of the Lenovo ThinkSystem SR650 V2 server. And it does support a lot, but there are limits. I mean, it's only 2U, and if you max out on storage, no GPUs. Or if you load up on GPUs, not as much storage potential. I'm sure there's a happy medium in there too. As you contemplate all these features, check out IT Creations using one of the links below or one of those right there. We have this system and many others. If you have any questions on this system, or if you're having technical difficulties with some used up, ready for replacement unit, then post a message in the comments below. You never know, we could have the answer to your lifelong question. Till next time, I'm Doug Stuman with IT Creations, and thanks for watching.